our neighborhood at the time, I lived between 62nd and 63rd on First, was Italian but bounded by Irish, and there were very distinct demarcations at that time, 57th to 61st being nominally Irish, up to 65th Street being Italian, above that to what, 70th Street, Czech Broadway, First Ave. Then it became Hungarian. There was a Hungarian Eating Society that existed, believe it or not, up until just a few years ago. And then it became German, obviously, leaving it to Yorkville. So I'm in the Italian block, and everybody had their own churches, but they shared the parochial school. And there was, so I'm in the Italian section, and everybody claimed that they would never allow the mafia to come in. Not that you felt the presence strongly, but there were a lot of people who, then a name would come up and nobody would talk about that person. And you felt that they really were afraid to talk about that person. So, so I'm going to tell stories that are kind of like tripartite. I was a wave of kind of like young professionals who were just beginning to come into the neighborhood. And so we heard a lot of stories and saw a lot of things that just don't exist anymore. The first involves a guy, Jackie, who was the nicest kid in the world. He was like 13 years old, a little underage, but working at the then finest supermarket that's where the Chase Bank is now at 62nd and 2nd. Delivered groceries you do anything for anyone. And lo and behold, one of the elderly ladies that he delivered groceries for left him about $8 million. And he continued to work at the finest for quite a long time. And then he sort of like disappeared from the scene. He lived in on First between 60th and 61st. Although he had an Italian name, he was thought of in the neighborhood as Irish. Go figure, I don't know. But in any event, I'm traveling a lot for business and I'm kind of losing in contact. And then, I don't know, his name comes up because he had disappeared from the neighborhood scene. And as it turned out, very sadly, he just had become a complete kind of hermit, living in his apartment and having drugs delivered on a regular basis. And we don't know what happened to him. Actually, I tried on this project to go to the Social Security Death Index, newspapers, that anyone had ever done a follow-up story, because when he inherited this money, the Daily News, all of the tabloids, even the Times did an article about, this lovely kid. And so we don't know what happened to Jackie. We're trying to find out because it was a great thing that happened in the neighborhood, and even though it had kind of a sad ending. The other, story number two, my neighbor, who lived right under me, who was the child of Colombian immigrants, and these were really peasant folk, and who really didn't really even understand education and its value. But Carlos apparently was the number one student in Bronx science. He graduated, and then he went to Fordham. It was just like something where they didn't really have a science program. And for about, a semester, dropped out, started waiting tables at very expensive restaurants. And so there he was in the apartment underneath me. His passions were the highest fidelity recording equipment for his massive collection of LPs ever. The English bands at the time, Ethan Allen furniture, And well, he was, when not working, pretty much like stoned all the time. But even then, he could repair anything in your apartment, your air conditioning, whatever. Then lo and behold, he worked at very expensive restaurants and really made very good money, to the point where I went with him one day and repaid cash for an XKE, a Jaguar, that when there was then a showroom on 57th Street. And we kind of like, we didn't like drive it off the showroom floor, but close to. Anyway, he one night is waiting table at Four Seasons and recognizes the person whose table he's waiting at. It was a guy and his wife, a guy he used to help with, who it now turns out is like head of systems at IBM. He was back in school so fast. He was probably like 28 at the time. Just, I mean, all you know, didn't hear a sound out of his, it was just like studying. Ultimately, he was the co-designer of the medical records program that now is like with Obamacare is everywhere. And he lives in baronial splendor in San Diego. And happy guy with, he has like six kids who, he told me, their median IQ is 140. the last story is, and I don't know where we are time-wise, but there's a like a wild and crazy guy who lives on the block who is kind of like, we think of him as Anthony Doorman Drag Queen, and which he does for children's charities. He was born in the building on the block. His parents, his mother, I remember as being like the most dour person imaginable. She'd like never smile or laugh all the time, even though her husband was living. Never had like two words to say to anybody. Dad was sort of like a large guy, but a Nebuchadnezzar guy. He was like, would never talk to any guy. Well, as it turns out, mom and dad were from two Italian families that they didn't like each other. But mom was like the powerhouse in the relationship, and she was like totally insistent they be married. And so they were, in terms of the day it arrives for the ceremony. They're standing on First Avenue in front of, for those who walk down that way, the Sutton Pizzeria. And when a car pulls up and fires bullets at the wedding party's feet, the bride removes a revolver from her wedding bouquet and fires back. Okay, so they proceed to Our Lady of Peace Church, which is on 62nd Street. Currently, there's a big campaign. They did a beautiful job restoring it, doing it. The Italian immigrants really, they've got just fantastic Murano chandeliers, but I mean, tasteful and beautiful. And Dublin is trying to close it now, and they're having vigils and everything to try and defend it. So, you know, more power to them, and I hope they do. So they head over, they're at the church, they're at the altar, and the same guys come in the back of the church. The priest dives under the altar, and the bride removes her revolver again and waves it around. The guys disappear, and they live happily ever after. And so, very many of the buildings are still owned by the families who kind of pioneered the area. It was when they built the 2nd and 3rd Avenue L's that it opened up that area for residential. People were able to move off the Lower East Side. And my building, in 1893, we're talking eight units, There were 60, the police did a census for some reason. There were 64, 65 people living in the building, so it meant the people were really renting place on the floor, asleep. By, and it was everybody, Jews, Irish, Germans, you name it. By the 1910 census, everything had sorted itself out ethnically. Yeah, 57 to 62nd was Irish, then Italian. Anyway, a lot of them still do business, even though they don't live in the neighborhood anymore. Most of the businesses have been there for a really long time, and there's a real feel in the neighborhood, I must say. The one time I was ever followed home, I didn't see it, the guys in the pizza store did. And they just beat the holy crap out of the person who was following. And oftentimes I think, oh, well, they're more beautiful places to live. They're maybe more convenient places to live, but until a joke of building I'm carried off, I'll probably be living there. Thank you very much.